joined here with Andy Nowicki. So last week we had Jack Donovan on to talk about his new book, The Way of Men. And Andy Nowicki, we discussed this with Jack Donovan. I brought this up where Jack Donovan had an article. It's called The Problem with Squares, and Andy Nowicki has a response up called The Defense of Squares. So it's nice having you back on the show. Well, first of all, what was your overall take on Jack Donovan's article? Have you read his book?
I have not read The Ways of Men by Jack Donovan yet, and thank you for having me again on your show. It's good to be here again. No, I have not read Jack's book yet, but I'm interested in it. It sounds very interesting. And what the exchange that you're referring to started when Jack wrote a write-up for The Ways of Men, his new book, at the Countercurrents site, counter-currents.com. And in that write-up, he discussed masculinity, and he used this particular example from a John Waters movie, which I have not seen, Crybaby, featuring Johnny Depp. And but the plot twist, or the characters in the movie that he described, are characters that I've seen in many movies myself, and that is apparently, it's about a love triangle between some cool, slick, greaser bad boy and this more preppy, more guy who plays by the rules kind of guy. And the girl in the movie is the girlfriend of the preppy guy, but she, of course, really wants the dangerous bad boy guy. And Jack was using this metaphor, or using this the example from this movie, to try to talk about the allure of forbidden masculinity and so forth. And to me, it kind of tied in with a lot of the issues that are discussed in Mala Fide, the website that's all about game, with Ferdinand Bardamu, I think is how you say his name. I've never actually said his name before. I've just read it. But Ferd, an entertaining writer, writes a lot about how being an alpha that's what women really want these days, and blah blah blah. And so something in Jack's article kind of reminded me of that, and I was inspired to retort to Jack's article, not to his book, because again I hadn't read it and I still haven't read it at this point, although, as I said, I do intend to read The Ways of Men. But I wrote an article in response to Jack's article where I pretty much took on the whole idea of, that it's important to cultivate this this dangerous masculinity and to be a bad boy and an alpha and all that. And I was more or less trying to stick up for the betas, as they're called in those circles, or the squares, the nerds, the geeks, if you will, because I'm one of them, I always have been. And
that is, I just finished the book, The Columbine Pilgrim. That is kind of the the main character, the protagonist, or you could say anti-heroes, I guess a better word, is kind of he fits more of that profile.
Yes, definitely. And that book, people who have read it might be kind of frightened to hear this, but there is some autobiographical there is an autobiographical component to the character of Tony Meander in my book, The Columbine Pilgrim.
I don't mean to pick on you so much, but I noticed the picture you posted of yourself when you were young. You had the hair you had, all this curly hair. I noticed you described Tony Meander. You said he had a white man's afro.
Yes, indeed. And so did I back when I had hair, as anyone can see. So I've got that kind of history, as far as this whole, there's something that's always just kind of stuck in my craw, I guess, about this whole idea that you gotta change, you gotta be cool. And I don't know if Jack and I have had exchanges since this time, and I don't really know if we don't basically agree on a lot of things with respect to this issue.
I gotta say, it ties in because the bully in the book kind of is more, he's kind of a bad boy kind of thing when he's young,
mm-hmm.
but he ends up, the Meander gets revenge at him, and mm-hmm. I guess I'm not gonna give away the graphic details, but it is, it is kind of, they're graphic and
mm-hmm.
Kind of disgusting as well.
Yes, indeed, well, definitely. yeah, it takes the whole idea of, you know, nerd revenge to a very uncomfortable extreme, my book does. And again, that's my book, The Columbine Pilgrim, which, again, I'm very happy to have, that you have read and encourage others to read it as well. So, yeah, so getting back to the whole exchange, so I wrote a retort, if you will, to Jack's article, and I published this article also at the Countercurrent site, and my article was called In Defense of Squares, because Jack in his article talked about how in this movie Crybaby, you know, the lines, the division between the alphas and the betas, or what we'd call the greasers and the nerds or whatever, the cool guys were called drapes and the nerdy guys were called squares. And so I my article was In Defense of Squares, and I basically said, you know, it was kind of a simple argument, maybe dressed up in some way. Or not even exactly an argument, just a response, just saying, be yourself. It sounds kind of trite to put it that way, but that is basically it. You know, if you are this particular way and girls don't like you, and you know, then... I was just like, fine, let girls not like you, you know, stop caring so much what girls think of you and just, you know, be who you are and take it from there. So to me, that was kind of, there's something much more manly about that, you know, about just, in a sense, giving up and giving it over to fate, acknowledging who you are, acknowledging how you've been created, you know, your essential personality. And if you know, the examples that I gave, you know, from a movie that I was more familiar with was, of course, the Star Wars trilogy, the original Star Wars trilogy, which I watched, of course, I was a huge fan of growing up. And the equivalent there are the two guys in the original trilogy, the two heroes, Luke Skywalker and Han Solo. You know, Han Solo was the equivalent of the bad boy, you know, the one who, the rogue who captures the, of course, Princess Leia falls for him. And Luke Skywalker was the other side. He was a nice guy. He was really into doing the right thing. He wanted to, you know, he was idealistic. He wanted to make a difference in the universe and all that.
I guess, a lot of movies deal with kind of that theme. I guess the other one is, I don't know if you've seen Hangover, but Bardamu wrote he actually had a good article over at Amalfita about the three characters, and I guess the movie The Hangover, where you had he talks about the three types. Have you seen that movie?
I have seen the movie. I haven't read the article in question that you're talking about now. But
so it was interesting. The main character, there's the one guy who's, I guess, there's a guy who's getting married, and he's the guy who's missing. Then there's kind of the bad boy. Then there's the nerdy dentist. And then there's Jack Galifianakis' character, who I guess he describes as what's the word? They were the pickup artist gamer types, call them Omegas. Like Jack, that's Jack Galifianakis' character.
right. Yeah, that's true. And I guess the equivalent here would be the nerdy dentist. I guess would be the kind of guy that I was, or the kind of guy that I'm talking about.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? In the movie, the nerdy Dennis is always, he's always kind of worrying what other people think about him and worrying about his wife. What's ironic is the sort of the bad boy, and then the Galifianakis character on the other ends, I guess, mm-hmm. When it comes to sort of attraction to the opposite sex, they're on opposite ends, but they both have kind of the same attitude, like they don't give an F what people think about them.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. And I guess that, you know, that's where Jack and I, when we talked about it afterwards, or we didn't actually talk, but we, you know, exchanged messages electronically afterwards. And I guess, you know, we ultimately maybe agree that the important thing is just not giving an F, as you say. To me, it seems like the pickup artist guys, these guys who are into game and all that, in some ways, it seems like they are willing to sacrifice themselves, sacrifice who they are, in order to play this role that they think will make them seductive. And maybe it works for them. I'm sure it does for a lot of them. To me, it's just like the question is, maybe you get a lot of sex that way, but is it worth the trade-off, you know? And I mean, personally, I'm a married man. I'm a family man. I don't, you know, condone the club scene. That's not my thing. But I'm just saying, looked at from their perspective, if that's what you want out of life, it still seems like there's really something missing, or you really sacrifice something of your essence in a way that to me really seems irksome. And there's something about, you know, if you are a beta or a nerd or a drape or whatever term you want to use, and you're not this way, you're not this roguish, handsome bad boy, whatever, Han Solo type, then that's okay. You don't have to be that kind of guy. And it bothers me to think, you know, that guys, I mean, it kind of touches my heart. I think there are guys, you know, who are like me, who just reproach themselves for being, you know, for being the way that they are, and somehow feel like they ought to be something different. Now, I mean, if I'm all for changing something about yourself, if something needs to be changed, but when we're not talking about, making yourself a more virtuous person, but just, you know, change, like the idea of taking on this other character just to be more alpha or, you know, more hip or more swaggering or whatever, you know, I just find that kind of appalling. And so that was the opinion that I expressed in my response to Jack Donovan's article. And then Bardamu wrote a response to my article, which I was very happy to read, and it was well written. It was entertaining, as his articles always are. But I took some issue with what he was saying, and then wrote another response to him. And so it was kind of a tempest in a teapot kind of thing. I don't know how many people really. I don't know if it really caused that much of a dust up, but it was an interesting exchange. And I think there were some points made on all sides, I guess, of the issue.
So I'll read you what some of the stuff that Bardamu said. He said, "I don't want to pick on Nowicki too much, but his argument is the male equivalent of a fat chick comforting her equally obese BFFF with Ben and Jerry's. You're too good for him, girl. You're fine just the way you are." And then he goes on and gets personal. So he kind of talks about his, I think Bardamu's probably close to my age, like mid to late 20s. But he talks about how he was. So he was obese when he was a kid, and he was a nerd. And he says that how he changed, he changed his life around, and that's what he's saying. So, but you, what is your response to his argument that it's like a fat chick converting an equally obese BFF, that you're too good for him, you're just fine the way you are? I guess Bardamu's argument is that people should try to improve themselves, but you say that's conformist.
Well, I would say I would say it's good to want to be in shape, to eat right, and to exercise, and, you know, take care of yourself. Those are all good things. So I don't take issue with that at all. And as far as projecting confidence, I mean, that's really the essence of what I'm saying, is that you should be confident, you should be comfortable with who you are, and not want to conform to what the chicks want you to be or what the alphas say you ought to be. So,
but there is a differentiation. I guess some people want to conform or just for the sake of conformity, for sort of the peer pressure or acceptance mm-hmm. by their peers. But yeah. with the game thing, I mean, someone can make the argument is, sex or attention from the opposite sex is something that most men strive for. Couldn't right. you say that that's a worthy thing? There is a difference between that and just conforming for the sake of conforming and getting acceptance of your peers.
Well, I don't know. By people who conform in the way that you talk about, it still seems like, yeah, I mean, men want to have sex with a lot of women. I don't think there's anything mysterious there. It's biological. It's part of how we were made for whatever reason. So, but I would say that, you know, biological urges aside, it's also about status, isn't it? I mean, there's some, for a lot of men, it's like you somehow become more worthy of a person the more women you sleep with. I definitely don't see things that way. So I would say, yeah, you do things for the right reasons or the wrong reasons, and we all conform. We all make a choice to conform, I think, because we want, those of us who do conform, we want the goods that we think conformity will bring us, you know, acceptance by our peers, status, and beautiful women liking us, okay, whatever. Whatever the reward may be, we conceive of the reward. Obviously, it's something that appeals to us, but I'm saying the more heroic, in some ways, the more manly way to be is to just take all of those things that you want and ask yourself, but is this who I am? Do I really need these things? You know, do I need the acceptance of my peers? Do I need women to like me? You know, maybe that's just not, you know, who I am. And if it isn't, I don't think there's anything wrong with being who you are. Now, again, if we're just talking about changing in some way to make yourself healthier or changing in some way to that you get, you know, that boosts your confidence in yourself or makes you more comfortable with who you are, then I'd say that's fine. That's good. But, yeah, I would definitely – I'm anti-conformity in that sense, in the sense of, you know, wanting these things for either the pleasure or for the status. You know, I would say stop caring about about how other people think of you, whether other men think you're a loser because you don't sleep with a lot of women, or whether women think you're, not appealing because, I don't know, you don't come across with this roguish swagger or whatever. You know, just don't worry about them and what they say and what they think. That's my take on the issue.
But a lot of it is about confidence, and mm-hmm. I think true confidence comes from, I think you do kind of in conformity, you lose that, because you're not going to be proud of who you are. So in a sense, I guess it's kind of fake confidence.
Yeah. And I you said that Bardamu got personal. To be fair, he didn't get personal with me. He got personal about himself. So he gave us the autobiographical details about what kind of a childhood he had and how he was a shy, geeky kind of kid and so forth. And then I, in my article, especially in my second article, my reply to Bardamu, I went into a little bit of autobiographical detail about myself as well, and talked about a couple of things, a couple of incidents that I could recall from my adolescence and from my college years that kind of stick out to me now. And one of them I'll talk about now was when I was maybe 15 or 16 years old, there was some guy, some schoolmate, not anybody I was that close to, but he was a popular guy in school, or thought of himself as popular. Anyway, I'm not sure if he was as popular as he thought he was. But he took me aside and one day and basically said, look, you'll do a lot better with the girls if you stop using so many big words. And so at the time, of course, I was a little defensive about it, and, because I was an insecure adolescent and so forth. But, I did, of course, I would have liked to have had better acceptance from the fairer sex as a teenager. But there was something to me even then about this whole idea that, oh, I've got to change the way I talk, I've got to, speak in monosyllables now or whatever, say cool things, or it's basically the same thing as changing your hair, changing your clothes, trying to be cool, trying to be hip. And even back then, and I did yearn to for acceptance. I think everybody does. But the thing is, you've got to just realize it's not that important. I mean, that's part of the step to manhood, is being able to say, if group X doesn't like me, or if I'm not accepted by this particular group or that particular group, so what? I'll manage. So there was that incident, which still sticks in my memory. And there was also a time that I recounted in my article, in which I was in college, and a girl started talking to me one day, and attractive girl, apparently liked me for reasons, that I'm not entirely sure, or was attracted to me for, in spite of my white man afro and my gawky, nerdy features, but, no accounting for taste. So we were talking, and then all of a sudden she asked what I was reading. I had a book with me, and it was a book by Soren Kierkegaard, Fear and Trembling. And so I showed it to her, and she said, oh, so it's for a class. And I said, no, I'm just reading it on my own. And then at that moment, it was just like, whoa, there's something wrong with this guy. He's reading this book by Soren Kierkegaard, and he's not even reading it for a class, And so I guess that, all of a sudden I was unappealing or undesirable for that reason. But again,
that's interesting. It says a lot about our culture that intelligence is associated with being kind of being nerdy, or it's undesirable.
Yeah. Yeah, it does. It does.
Do you think it's cultural, or do you think it has biological reasons?
Oh, man, I don't know. I mean, the people who theorize about biology and about how women like a particular kind of man because of evolutionary reasons, frankly, I don't know. I don't know about all that. It seems to me that everybody has a complicated set of responses to any particular desire that's in their hearts, and attraction is how we find ourselves attracted to certain kind of people and not to others is, it obviously varies from individual to individual. I'm sure there are some women out there who would have thrown themselves at my feet for me being a Kierkegaard reader and at age 19 or 20. But they would be in the minority, obviously. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe there. I think what you're saying is true, though. There is, I think that we are in some ways an anti-intellectual culture, and people who think, who ponder big questions are seen as wasting their time and not really doing anything. We're very oriented towards action, taking action. You want to be a man of action, and so forth and so on. So yeah, I mean, there's a possibility of that. I don't know. I'm not really prepared to answer the question, but it's an interesting one to think about.
Welcome back. I'm here with Andy Nowicki. So we're discussing his article in defense of squares, and it's interesting the topic you bring up about the anti-intellectual. I also think it's true among, I mean, you're kind of loosely affiliated with the alternative right, but among mm-hmm. a lot of the mainstream conservatives or just people who identify with the right, they associate being an intellectual with kind of being a lefty. There is a strong kind of anti-intellectual culture, and they sort of mm-hmm. adopt the stereotype that sort of the Hollywood puts out of conservatives of being kind of the dumb, some kind of like dumb anti-intellectual, hyper macho redneck.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I remember hearing Rush Limbaugh one day talk about how, who I think does his part to further that whole image of conservatives, whether he's a true conservative or not. I don't want to really touch that whole question right now. But as far as promoting this whole mentality, I remember him saying one day that you can't trust people who straight A kind of people. You want people who made C's and D's a lot in school. They're the ones who really know how to do stuff. I don't know. I'm not sure what the context was exactly for this, but he said it with such, you know, gruff confidence that, you know, oh yeah, we can't trust those people with straight A's. They're just a bunch of geeks they're just, I guess, a bunch of wonky type of guys who don't really know how to make it in the real world.
I don't have evidence of this, but just thinking hypothetically, maybe there is some conspiracy among the elites of trying to keep the sort of they want to kind of, I guess, to maybe dumb down society in general, but maybe mm-hmm. they feel more threatened by the right, like I say, because of maybe nationalism, so they want to kind of keep the right dumbed down. So maybe maybe there is some kind of conspiracy.
Yes, I don't know. That's true, though. I think among the my comrades, I guess, our comrades in the alternative right movement, there are plenty of more geeky kind of guys who are into literature and classical music and, you know, all those thought to be blue state, you know, effete blue state kinds of pursuits or what have you. It's definitely, I'm not sure, you know, about the conspiratorial idea. I think we can say maybe the left is right, is correct in saying there is an anti-intellectualism to much of American culture, to the so-called red state culture. The people who voted in George W. Bush, of whom I think we could say he's an exemplar of not a stupid guy, but I honestly don't think you become the most powerful man in the world by being stupid, but certainly not an intellectually curious kind of person, and definitely somebody who, you know, would be thought of as a guy's guy and as a, you know, a red-blooded kind of.
Yeah, there's a different type of intelligence. There's intellectual kind of curiosity, as you were saying, or more mm-hmm. of a kind of a conformist intelligence, like someone who sort of mm-hmm. climbs the corporate ladder.
Yeah, somebody who, and I guess that's what a politician does. I mean, has to learn what people want to hear and how they want to hear it and talk to them the way that they want to be talked to.
With George W. Bush, I think people say he was stupid, but I think that kind of describes him. He was very definitely anti-intellectual, but, mm-hmm. I mean, he had some level, obviously, to rise to that position of power, even though he came from a powerful, I mean, a lot of people say he was kind of handed down a lot of stuff with a silver spoon, but he had some mm-hmm. basic kind of practical intelligence, but definitely he sort of represents that because he's totally sort of anti-intellectual. Mm-hmm. And kind of John Kerry, like, kind of was the stereotypical kind of liberal, elitist, mm-hmm. intellectual type.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, all that is true, yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, I think we can probably take it in a lot of directions and ask about what the real, as far as the crisis of masculinity in the modern age, which
I gotta read this, what you said to kind of wrap up the Bardamu article.
Yes.
You said did no part of, in reference to Bardamu, was like saying, screw you ladies, I'm tired of trying to be the man you want to be. You're a fickle taster, shallow and worthless. Cobain today, Bieber tomorrow, and as much as I'd like to bet as many of you as possible, I'm not such a slave to my sex drive to be one of those worthless gamers. Sayonara, bitches.
Yeah, well, that was a response to, and of course I was being kind of humorous there, trying to be humorous, but that was a response to Bardamu. He talked about how, in his article, he was saying this whole idea of essentialism, that there's something at our core, who we really are, but he was saying, no, that's not true. He was saying, you can habituate yourself to change, and then you become somebody different. So the nerd that he was when he was 15, 16 years old, is not the swaggering pickup artist that I guess he is now, whatever age he is now. And just that he took on these new habits, and slimmed down and worked out and so forth, and became this confident guy. And that's all well and good. But the problem was, he talked about playing in an alternative band, playing some really crappy alternative rock songs, learning how to play in a band and dressing a certain way and growing a goatee and all this kind of stuff. And so, yeah, so that kind of put me to mind of the kind of guy who looks around, wets his finger, holds it up into the air, and says, what kind of look do the ladies like these days? How do I get women to like me?
That's interesting about Bardamu, because he sort of, in that sense, can be a conformist. But, I mean, if you read his blog, he's definitely, his views are non-conformist.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the impression that I get too. A lot of defiance, which is good. I like defiance. But in this, that particular part of his article just sounded a lot too much, very much like somebody who was just, I don't know, for ulterior motives, to boost his ego, to look for status. And I don't know whether this is actually true about him. I'm not being personal about his life. For one thing, I don't know anything about his life. But just speaking in general, the whole idea that you go after this, cultivate this particular look to try to score, as it were, or to try to promote this image of being this alpha type of guy. That just seemed, it's never appealed to me. I've got to say that. Even when I was, a young and impressionable adolescent, it didn't appeal to me then. It doesn't appeal to me now. So, and I kind of wish that there was more, interest in not conforming, even if it means being lonely, even if it means kind of having to adapt or to adopt a more stoic point of view on life.
Jack Donovan, we'll go. I'll let you finish. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I would like to see more of that, more hearty stoicism, more of this whole. I would like to see more of a defiant spirit, more of a middle finger to the whole, we're going to try to win you over and get you to be this particular kind of guy, and then we'll reward you by giving you status and power and sexual favors and, making you feel popular and handsome and so forth. I'd like to see more among men, because I think this is a really important thing for men in particular. I'd like to see more of this of a defiance against that.
So with Jack Donovan's book, I had him on. The premise of the book is that the way of men is the way of the gang. And in mm-hmm. a sense, I mean, he's not, Jack Donovan's not, he's a nonconformist himself, but he is correct in analyzing, I think, the nature of masculinity. And mm-hmm. in a sense, in a gang of men, in a group, there is going to be, I mean, there's going to be a hierarchy and there's going to be pressure to conform, but there's different groups. I mean, there are obviously some groups of men that are just some kind of dissidents or rebelling against the status quo. Mm-hmm. But to be part of a group like that or a gang, you do have to conform to a degree. So in mm-hmm. some sense, so you can't really be totally nonconformist. So that is mm-hmm. I think, the premise of his book, that the way of men is the way of the gang.
Yeah, well, that sounds about right from what I've read about the book. Again, I haven't read it yet, but and it sounds like, you know, it seems like Jack is also very interested in trying to restore this kind of hardy and defiant masculinity that's been lost in the modern age, the feminized postmodern age that we live in now. And I'm all for that. You know, that sounds good to me. I think what really just set me off with Jack's article was the whole, his invocation of this John Waters movie where the bad boy is the one that the girls all want, which is true to life, you know, let's face it. But if you're not that guy, then you're not that guy. And again, there's something, I think, manly about and confident in its way. You could even say alpha-like. About the nerdy or the geeky guy who doesn't care, you know, who's okay with being the way he is, who's okay with being unpopular. Of course, you know, I and this is a point I make in the article, two articles I wrote as well. I wound up getting married and having children, being happily married as I am today at age 41. So, you know, I wouldn't have thought that I would, that life would take me down this particular course, but you never know. But anyway, it's not about, you know, it shouldn't be about trying to do what you can to work things in such a way that you'll get acclaim or attention or status. I'm just very much against that. I think. A real man doesn't respond in that way. That's, I guess, the problem that I have with a lot of what I perceive as the whole game mentality.
Well, what is ironic is that the term square, originally meant kind of conformist, and in the movie, the squares were definitely conformist. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them, but they had, I mean, they kind of depicted them as having pretty girlfriends and whatnot. But mm-hmm. if you look at the other characters were more kind of like the rebels. The squares were sort of the conformist. Mm-hmm. But the irony is then being today it's kind of being square is being nonconformist when originally it meant being conformist, and that's where, that's the irony behind that.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, yeah, I'm not sure if I can add anything to that right now, but it's definitely true. It's kind of like what it puts to mind for me, and I almost mentioned this in the article. You're too young to remember this, but in the 80s there was this movement, there was an offshoot of the punk movement called the Straight Edge movement. I think they're still around today. A group of kids who were against alcohol and against drugs and against promiscuous sex, just because, you know, just like I was saying in the article, screw you. I mean, if that's what, these are the things I'm supposed to be doing in order to be cool, then, you know, screw that. And of course, maybe in their case it might have developed into a kind of different conformism, since these were gangs of their own, which had their own rules. But in a general sense, I think there is something really good to having that whole that defiant mentality with respect to you know the whole idea, the notion of being cool and avoiding being quote square and so forth.
Well, speaking about being nonconformist, I think there's the, we talked about having nonconformist views, and I think a good example, you wrote about John Derbyshire, mm-hmm. and he was fired because he didn't fit in with the conformity of a national review. He didn't.
Yep.
So I think that's important. What is your take on that? You wrote an article for the Alternative Right on Derbyshire, and that's been discussed on the network recently.
Yeah. I wrote on Derbyshire before he was actually fired by National Review, but it was when, for some reason, The Guardian, you know, this newspaper, which has a large subscription, a major newspaper, decided to, you know, write this article saying, look at John Derbyshire writing an article at TalkieMag.com. And it just seemed like overkill, and like they were going after him, you know, for something that really was not a major news story. But of course, everybody piled on, and then as we all knew would happen, Rich Lowry caved in and National Review fired him. And I was really impressed with how Derb responded. I don't know him at all. Never met him. You know, I've read him off and on, but he absolutely responded with, you know, without an apology, without any kind of groveling or abjectness. He just came right back, you know, and said, and without, you know, putting on too much of an attitude either, but he just basically said, hey, look, you know, this is what I wrote. It's what I still believe. That's the way it is. And I think you've got to admire that, even if you don't agree with Derb's article. And I'm not even talking about the substance of what he wrote. But, you know, they're just, I long to see that, more of that. You know, people who aren't, who say what they're going to say, and then, you know, when people get mad or offended, they don't just cave in and get all intimidated and beg for forgiveness. That's enormously appealing. And we need more men like that. We absolutely do.
Because, I mean, being, when you talk about views, I mean, obviously being politically correct is the ultimate form of a kind of conformity. Yeah. And it's kind of ironic how, I mean, I talked about kind of how the Antifa types, they think they're called radicals for the establishment.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, like it's kind of like you see people at a neo-Nazi rally, and there's 10 skinheads holding swastika flags, and they're flanked by like 50 policemen and then like 500 counter-protesters, you know, and it's like, well, who's really, you know, of course, I'm not a Nazi, I don't condone Nazism or the Nazi point of view, but in that circumstance, who's really representing the challenge to the status quo? You know, what takes more guts? You know, and I think a lot that can be said in many ways about the zeitgeist in which we live.
And I got a comment on one more interesting observation about about that film and the drapes and the squares. Donovan makes an observation, even though the drapes are they're white, but he does kind of say it's a symbolic thing, could be of race, where the squares represents. Donovan says the squares kind of represent whites and the drapes represent blacks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I can, the drapes in this movie, which I haven't seen, but they are like the greaser types, you know, like Fonz on Happy Days, or like the or like John Travolta's character in Grease. That's what they are. They're like the, you know, the cool guys, the bad boys. But yeah, it's definitely something to think about. I don't know as far as the racial thing goes. I mean, Donovan actually said they were blacks, or they represented
no,
blacks?
No, they were white, but there is some scene in the movie about where there, I forget the contents, but they, I really got to think of it, but there's something about them. Well, they sort of did admire kind of black culture.
Mm-hmm.
That is true. I think, forget the specific context Donovan brought up, but it is, but he kind of made that argument that the squares kind of represent whites.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess whites have been kind of in the past, I mean, whites were sort of viewed as the establishment, or kind of, and it kind of became, I mean, whites were viewed as squares, so being, I mean, black culture was viewed as kind of rebellious. And then, but the irony is, it's the same thing. Black culture is conformist, and you have the kind of it's kind of died down. But there's the whole Wigger phenomenon among white suburban teens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. I understand that. Yeah, and I'm making the connections now in my mind. I'm remembering. Yeah, he's saying that the black men have this masculinity that they can relate to, and that white men need something similar, something, and that explains the, you know, like the white kids in the suburbs dressing like gangster rappers or whatever, talking like gangster rappers, because they want to have something, you know, of substance to connect to, that's masculine, that's not, you know, emasculated, which is, again, what he's saying in his article. Was kind of what the WASPy types, the squares were. They didn't have this raw kind of essence of masculine power. But it is interesting. It goes in cycles, I guess. You see, and so now you see people. You know, it gets to the point, and it's always been this way for me. It's always seemed like cool. The whole idea of being cool is in itself such a, you know, such a an oppressive conformity, you know, being pushed on you from above, that, you know, true nonconformity is not being cool, and it's almost being, as you say, square again in some ways, which is why I was saying in my article in defense of squares.
We're out of time, so I'd like to thank you for being on.
Yes, well, thanks for having me.
That's all we have for, so take care.